do something about gun violence. The purpose of this hearing was to focus on the federal resources that can help the police solve the crime and bring peace to the neighborhoods and communities of our state, including, of course, the city of Chicago. What we heard from John Lausch, the U.S. Attorney for the Northern District of Illinois, is that the Attorney General has initiated a joint strike force effort to deal with violent gun crime. That is long overdue. I'm glad that the Biden administration is doing that. What do we have to do? Well, first off, we have to make sure that we do our best to slow down the trafficking of guns into the city of Chicago and the state of Illinois. Many of those guns are coming from states as far away as Mississippi and as close as Indiana, and they are being identified through tracing as guns that are used in the commission of crime. One gun, for example, that was stolen in Wisconsin was reported to have been used in 27 different crimes before it was finally confiscated by the police. We also know that, deadly things are happening in the streets on a regular basis, not only people being shot and killed, but also our police officers who are being shot at and at a record level that we've never seen before. Morale is a challenge, the superintendent told us, with the Chicago police, and it's a reminder that although no one will ever try to justify or explain the outrageous conduct which occurred in Minnesota and has occurred even in this area, the vast majority of women and men in blue get up every morning and put on their badges and risk their lives for all of us. We need to tell them thanks, because without them we cannot solve this gun violence challenge. What I'm going to do is to focus on several things. First, straw purchasing. This idea that you can go into a gun store in Indiana and say that you want to buy a half dozen handguns for your own personal use, many times it's obvious on the face of it that these guns are being fenced and passed along to others who cannot legally pass a background check. We need to put some teeth in that law so there's enforcement against straw purchasers. The girlfriend purchasers have to face time in prison for doing that. Why is it so important? Because Ella French, one of our Chicago police officers, who lost her life in August, was a victim of a straw purchase gun. It's a reminder of how deadly this decision can be and how important it is for us to respond. We are going to have a hearing in the Senate Judiciary Committee on many of these issues, and I already know, unfortunately, the outcome. But it's important that members of the Senate of both political parties go on record on these issues for serious, comprehensive background checks to keep guns out of the hands of convicted felons and others who are disqualified, to make sure that straw purchasing becomes a serious crime, to do something about ghost guns, which are showing up more and more in our state and other states. These are guns you can order through the internet who have no identification or serial numbers. Those are a way to avoid any criminal responsibility at a later date. They have to be treated as serious weapons. Let me stop at this point, thank my colleagues and three others who came to this hearing to say a few words. I'd like to turn it over to them and make a statement if they wish. I think Senator, you want it first?
First and foremost, I want to thank Senator Durbin for holding this hearing. We have to continue to talk about this every day. This cannot become the norm. It's a multifaceted problem, and there's multifaceted solutions, and I'm happy that I have a partner like Senator Durbin to work on these issues with. And as he said, trafficking and straw purchasing is of the utmost importance, but also we have got to invest in these communities and in people. These are real people dying, not just statistics. So hopefully we'll get the Build Back Better Act passed, where there's $5 billion in that bill to help communities. Thank you.
I want to also thank Senator Durbin for raising this issue loudly and clearly and having testimony that shows that things can actually be done. 125 people on average die every day because of guns, the accessibility of guns. In Evanston, Illinois, where I live, just 2 weeks ago, a young person was murdered and four other teenagers between the ages of 14 and 18 were shot at, one dead. This is everywhere in our communities, and we need a federal answer. We need the Congress of the United States, Republicans joining Democrats in the House of Representatives that have passed very, very popular gun safety legislation, background checks. Over 80% of Americans support that. We need to do it. And Dick Durbin, as the chair of the Senate Judiciary Committee, is leading the way. I just want to also say that there is $5 billion in the Build Back Better Act for community violence intervention programs that really work, but we also have to support our law enforcement, and I am just grateful for being here with him and with all of you today. Thank you.
So Sean Kasten from the 6th District. I want to echo my colleagues in thanking Senator Durbin for having this conversation. I'm grateful I was here to talk about gun trafficking, my own bill, the Gun Trafficker Detection Act, which would say that if you lose your gun, you're a responsible gunner, you lose track of it, you have 48 hours to report it to the ATF, and if you fail to report it, you would then bear civil liabilities for what's done with your gun. It's no different than we do with our cars. If my daughter takes out my car and crashes it, I'm liable. Why do we not have that same accountability for guns? But at the same time, I just want to acknowledge at a personal level, I'm sick of having this conversation. I've lost track in my 1.5 terms in Congress of how many times we've had moment of silence on the floor for people who've been shot. Going out to the city of Aurora with Congressman Foster to recognize the pain of those communities after that shooting out there. Going to a candlelight vigil on the 10th anniversary of the NIU shooting, and then the next day hearing about the shooting in Parkland. And then sitting here today and hearing Superintendent Brown say to us so eloquently that he has never seen a tense situation made safer by the presence of a gun. We have too many guns. And until we're willing to have the conversation that if we got rid of half the guns in America, we would still have more guns per capita than any other country in the world, that is the problem, and we've got to address it. So thank you for your leadership, Senator, and let's keep our eye on the ball.
Any questions? Well, of course, people can be skeptical, and rightly so, because we have not passed, with all the terrible things that have occurred, the shootings that have occurred, you think, wait a minute, they just shot up a first grade classroom, 20 little kids, boys and girls, and their teachers were killed. That should be it. That's the moment when America will do something. Oh, wait a minute, there was a shooting at a concert in Las Vegas, and all these people, these innocent people were killed. Or in Michigan recently, this high school situation. It really appears that we are really stalled and stuck in Washington. But those of us who are on the side of gun safety are going to push it anyway. We believe members of the Senate should be placed on record as to where they stand so that people back home know. And if gun safety is important to you and your family and the place where you live, those who are stopping it should be identified. There is a generational challenge here. Many of these young people who turn to guns and gangs have had events in their lives which shape who they are. All of us should pause for a second and think, what is the one enduring memory you have of your childhood? I hope it's a good one, but it may be a bad one. And for many of these young people, it was a bad situation that has allowed to go from bad to worse. That's why we brought the Chicago Crime Lab in to talk about the programs that are trying on a generational basis to give these young people a chance to look at life in a more positive way and to avoid violence as part of the answer. That is certainly what needs to be done. But I might add quickly, the generational part of this is important, it's necessary, but it's not sufficient in terms of dealing with today's gun violence. We've got to deal with both. help building the community, rebuilding the lives of young people, but keeping families and their kids safe every single day. I have a bill to do that. It's got to be more than a bookkeeping violation, because a U.S. attorney takes a look at all that's necessary to prosecute it, and most of the time shrugs their shoulders and says, it just isn't worth all this time and effort. We've got to make it worth the effort, because that, unfortunately, is a source of so many crime guns. Maybe, just maybe. It is not one of the high big ticket items in terms of political controversy. We may be able to get that through. We have a long list, and as was mentioned by Jan, or perhaps by Robin, 80% of the American people are with us, including the majority of gun owners in terms of background checks. But the gun industry is so powerful. We know it. We see it every single day. If there's anything that slows down their sale of weaponry, they put the brakes on it. And we've got to challenge them. It's our job to do what's right, even if we're not successful the first time. Well, we obviously should trace these weapons. And the record keeping at the Alcohol and Tobacco and Firearms and Explosives Agency is primitive by design. The industry has made sure that we keep written records on certain things, huge volumes of paper that just indicate that they really are not serious about law enforcement. I'm going to rely on Joe Biden for some of this. I think the president's heart is in the right place, and if he can do some of this by executive order or administratively, I'm going to encourage him to do everything he can. Exactly. I couldn't understand that, and I thank the agency for testifying. 10 times the number of inspections. One of the cities was Dallas, and I don't think the other, Kansas City, I think. 10 times the number of inspections is in this area. We're going to follow through on that. I think they can do a better job. They should. Okay? Thanks, everybody.